So, welcome to everybody. Welcome to our first Estonian-French Polar Forum. But very honestly, it's already second between us and Tara Ocean Foundation. But about it, we talk later. At the moment, the first thing I must do, I must give the greetings from the president of Estonian Polar Club, Andres Tarand, who unfortunately it was not possible for him to come today. Some words about the club. So we work by the museum approximately already 40 years. And mainly the members of the club are different researchers who have worked in Arctica or Antarctica, or who have been in one or another way connected with the polar activities. So here in Estonia, people are used with our polar forums. During the winter and autumn time, once a month we usually organize such events, but never in summer. So this is very extraordinary for us. And that's why not all the members of the club managed to come, because July, it's such a period that the people are away. But doesn't matter. We are all very happy that you are here, that Tara is here. Legendary ship about whom we have heard so much and read, because of our people who have worked and sailed together with Tara. And that's why the first person who will talk will be Timo Palo, polar researcher, adventurer, and he's looking back at the days of life on Tara, sea ice in 2007. So memories and outcome from Tara Arctic. Let us go to the past first, to the cold part. Please, Timo.
Okay, yeah, hello from me. My name is Timo Palo, as Katrin already mentioned. And I have been studying polar areas for more than 10 years. And I have been related to Tara. I think I can call myself Taranaut. There is this kind of notion. And boy, yeah, I still feel my heart is pumping. We just visited the boat and a lot of memories what came up. There's still some similarities from the Arctic days. So, and today I thought that I would make a quick flashback to these Tara Arctic trip days back in 2007. What was the Arctic research context at that time? What we knew about the changes in the Arctic? What actually preceded to this period, how we actually finally reached to that point that drift was initiated, and what we're following in the mean of science and research after that trip. Well, it all could say that for Arctic, it all started in 90s, end of the last decade of the last century. Myself, I was at that time too young to be part of this research. But that was very interesting, very exciting time, because first signs that something is going on, that Arctic is warming faster than other places on Earth, they started to reveal. And of course, that created some momentum in the Arctic research community. And these were actually oceanographers who first took the initiative and started those discussions and questioning about research needs. So actually, this climate change already in the 90s was anticipated by the models. Models demonstrated that due to the human-caused climate change, the first and foremost, the signs should be revealed in the Arctic. So we expected actually that warming must be higher there, faster there. But observations and what we actually saw, this picture was quite puzzling still at that time. So it was quite opposite what we have today, when models tend to be one or two steps behind of the observations of what we see. These changings are really remarkable. What taking place today in the Arctic and models tend to be behind. That was quite opposite in the 90s. So it was still a rather confusing time with many puzzling patterns. And there were reasons, like at this very critical time, the signals were not yet large enough to stand out from the background noise. This is the typical, like, climate system is not linear. So some of the signals, it takes time before they really get visible. And there was so many still like natural cycles and variations which overshadowed the real signals what we were expecting. For instance, like two big atmospheric circulation systems, North Atlantic Oscillation and Arctic, its bigger brother Arctic Oscillation, which at that time really captured the research community's attention. So they draw that attention away from the real causes. And these changes were explained partially or majorly as a natural. But changes, they kept coming. And so the research community needed to react somehow. So the things really finally started to clear up in the when the new century started after the millennia change in the beginning of 2000s. There were available ice thickness measurements, sonar measurements made by submarines between 76 and 98 and 99. And these revealed really the first tragedy of the Arctic climate change, that the ice thickness, especially the multi-year ice, had been decreased remarkably. So later it has really called this the beginning of the 2000s as the start of the new era for Arctic, the warm Arctic period. So it was quite clear that more and better data was much needed, and that was the call for the next IPU, and that brought alive the Tara Tamokles program, which was quite a huge, the biggest effort the EU put into the Arctic research at that time. And I think that was really perfect timing and the research context and what happening for Tara Drift. So the stage was really set and now we simply had to go and measure what's going on. So that was my first glimpse from the aircraft DC-3 when flying from Longyearbyen to Tara after the first winter. I had been there already in 2006 when we prepared the ice camp and deployed a lot of scientific equipment. But that when this was the return day, and that really caught me because this is something what I like in polar areas and regions. That's why I go there. That's what I like, that you feel yourself as a tiny creature, really like a piece of dust in the middle of the great whiteness, the huge icy landscape, and you can feel the fragility of the human being in the middle of these natural forces, and you can really experience those forces. You need to cope with them, you need to adapt to them, and sometimes you need to even fight against them. So this snowbird Tara was really captivating and fascinating, and really reminded me drift days from Nansen from more than 100 years ago. So I would say that the Arctic Ocean as a research field is a really different beast compared to the other polar regions or areas where I have been. It really is a bit like an unhumanistic place or place to where you could live. It's in a continuous movement. You're living on the surface of the ocean. It's in continuous movement. It changes. The landscape surrounding around you changes constantly. There are no similar days. They all can be very different. And it's your job to adapt the conditions. It's no point to make, or you can make bigger plans, but then you need to replan. And one of the great lessons what we first got there was the how to move on the sea ice. Like it's partially tricky in the summertime when ice starts melt. And 2007 was a very, very extraordinary year when summer melt was very intense, and we really could felt this famous albedo effect, one of the major contribution to the Arctic amplification, that which made our movement and maintaining the scientific equipment on the ice really, really tricky. That was the season, a lot of leapings, a lot of water skiing in rubber boots. It was first and only time I have done that. And it really gave me valuable lessons for later when I was some years later, when I was back in the Arctic Ocean with my friend on the way from North Pole back to home. So these lessons what I got from Tara were really, really valuable and one of the major support to our success. This is the one image what is actually not taken from Tara cruise, but afterwards when we were walking and yeah, that was in 2012, which was actually the next record-breaking minimum sea ice year after 2007. And we really felt how fast the ice was literally disappearing underneath of our feet. So we call it, it really reminded like a swamp, not really like a proper sea ice. Wherever you couldn't be very sure wherever you stepped there. It was very uncertain surface, and it was very stressful to walk on this surface there. So this type of rotten sea ice. And yeah, like I mentioned, in the Arctic you have to adapt to the, you have to be very flexible. So you can do plans, but be ready. You're gonna do many replannings. The major tasks or like challenges what we had there was this maintaining scientific equipment on this continuously moving and changing landscape. So this is on the left image, we were trying to recover some of the scientific equipment. As you see, there is a huge pressure ridge, a lot of rubble field. Ice has been pressurized and it was a big of a mess. So it's actually quite common, or you need to get used that. Sometimes you are not lucky and you can't recover everything, so you have some loss there. On the right image, another challenge which was in the Arctic was building a runway. It was already challenging in the spring, but in the autumn it's quite mission impossible, because in the autumn normally no planes flying to the Arctic. Sea ice is so unstable from the summer melt, and there are a lot of leaks, there are a lot of melt pools, slushy snow. This is not a good surface to land the aircraft. So we had to work to get the provisions and to get the crew chains. So it took us 2 weeks to work at two different sites. One of which is on this image is we call the swamp, because it was full of melt pools, and these were already covered with the fresh snow and slushy ice. So we had to break them like 400 meters long runway. We had to break them through in order to force them to freeze in these dropping temperatures. Unfortunately, it didn't work out. So 1 week job was lost there. Another week we had to fill with the snow on a runway, which was a bit tilted, like on an angle. And that one, another 1 week job also didn't work out. We were lucky to find another third place where we actually could land it, the aircraft. So these are just challenges. You have to be prepared and ready there. And it really is Arctic Ocean, like as I'm saying here, like living on the scruff on the another living beast. You feel like it's a living organism underneath your feet there. Why do you believe that Tara kind of station, polar station, is the perfect size, optimal size to do the research in the Arctic Ocean? It's the two reasons. Today we can't forget anymore the footprint we leave there, carbon, ecological footprint. This is one of the considerings we need to always take into account. And another is the crew size. I think we were a crew of 10. I believe this is quite a good, perfect size. You could do a lot of research work, but still we had the tight bonds. I really felt like living in the family, not in the crew. So I believe that the optimal size for Arctic Ocean research is somewhere between 10 and 20, depending of the research program, of course. On the left image, I was on a three-month cruise on the Chinese icebreaker, and that was quite an experience. There were 160 Chinese, two French, one Finnish, and one Estonian. And of this three-month cruise, nearly one-third you spend to get there and to get off from there. And imagine that icebreaker in the ice spends around 50 to 90, depends on the ice conditions, 50 to 90 tons of marine diesel. So I would say that we did much more at Tara. We collected much more data at Tara than we did on Chinara. There was another, this international program like Mosaic Trip, but that's a different scale. That was really, really huge one that took place a couple of years ago in the Arctic. But I think that we need to understand this relationship between the scientific productivity and the research group station size, and not forgetting the footprint we leave. Today it's more important than ever before. So outcomes of the drift. Already the drift speed itself of Tara was the first sign that something is going on. And as I mentioned, 2007 was a record-breaking in the September. We got the minimum sea ice, which was really unexpected. It was a huge drop from the previous record. And that Tara drifted 1.5 years, twice as fast as Nansen's Fram, although we reached further north. We had a more northerly trajectory than Nansen had. So, yeah, you drift faster when ice is thinner. There is less ice, it's more mobile. And we also had in this summer, actually, two main reasons. The summer melt was intense. There was a lot of warm air transported into the Arctic. But there was the second component, which was the tailwind component. Just the wind pattern was the one which pushed a lot of ice out of the Arctic into the Fram Strait. This research, what we carried out, Damocles Tara program, has resulted in many papers, and data is still being used nowadays and still has its value. And this program really advanced our understanding of these small-scale physical processes, which are actually the greatest challenge for modern models. Yeah, I think we really witnessed this Arctic transformation, its regime shift. I will show you later one paper which puts it that was the critical time when Arctic really changed from the first row seat. And this is one paper which sums it up nicely, all these advances in understanding of and parameterization of the small-scale physical processes. And that was both in the ocean, in the sea ice and in the atmosphere. So entire coupled climate system. These are Arctic drifts of the Tara. Russians last North Polar ice station was NP-40 in 2012. They once tried one more in 2015, but that only took 4 months. They had to abandon. Ice conditions were really poor, so it failed. From 2014-15 was Norway's Polar Institute research Fram was actually the hovercraft drift. Yeah, that was the small. This is the hovercraft here. Small two-man crew. One was actually Auden, my dear friend, who was also at Tara and who was with me on this North Pole trip. So he participated on this hovercraft drift one winter in the Arctic. But that was more geological study and geophysics, what they did there. And I believe really like two-man crew is a bit a dangerous cocktail in the Arctic Ocean. Lance drift was this NPI or North Polar Institute drift in the mouth of Fram Strait. They drifted 4 months in winter 2015. This is the Lance. Then of course Mosaic, as I mentioned, that was a huge multidisciplinary. Basically they put the polar stern, the huge icebreaker, into the ice and let it freeze, and they drifted 1 year over the Central Arctic. Russians have now built a new research platform, Severny Polyus, which is icebreaker-like, and they should be currently somewhere in the Arctic on their maiden voyage. What have been happened in the mean of research after Tara drift? It is sure that the Arctic is now in radical transformation, and the picture has been much cleared. And we know that we are now forerunned more warmer and profoundly different Arctic, which ultimately will be most probably sea ice free at the end of the summer. Research papers still say that Arctic climate modeling is still too conservative, still behind what we observe or what we see. And warming actually is no more twice as fast as the global average, but Arctic now warms 3 to 4 times fast as global average. That was one of the paper where some of my colleagues were participating. And another paper which put actually that this Arctic sea ice regime shift took place between 2005 and 2007. And you can clearly see this is the sea ice decreasing trend. And this is here now 2007, 2005. And you see it's totally another level now. It hasn't been returned after 15 years, and it probably never returns. This ice loss is likely irreversible. So Tara really was in the middle of the Arctic when this shift took place. There is more heat now in the oceans. So and then same as the more heat has been transported by atmospheric circulation into the Arctic. More cyclones, changed wind pattern, which pushes thicker and multi-year ice out of the Arctic. What's the future? So Arctic is a very complex system, and there's still many unknowns, and these consequences and effects on the climate system beyond the boundaries of Arctic are still a big question mark, and one of the focus where science is nowadays, how this system actually gives the feedback to the entire climate system, how our lives here are affected. So large-scale atmospheric and ocean circulation, the weather patterns. There is an Atlantification takes place, Arctic waters are warming, and it's quite evident. Barents Sea, we probably can't call it anymore part of the Arctic Ocean, it's more part of the Atlantic Ocean. And of course, changes in marine life are underway, but this is the place where we have much, much unknown things, and because our oceans are still so little studied, and there are still so many questions what needs to be answered. We were some years ago on Admiral Bellingshausen, we were in the Antarctic and visited US Palmer Station, which has a 50-year experience in ocean studies because of its location. It's very strong in oceanography and marine biology. And what the marine biologists talked are that the life in the Antarctic waters and species, genes, they're disappearing before they even can study them, and it happens in front of their eyes. So it's really racing with the time. Greenland is another big piece, Greenland ice sheet, which is showing huge warming signs. It's now melting 3 times faster than 30 years ago. So it's really waking up. And it's one of the possible tipping points, which is pushed really at the edge. So future of the Arctic sea ice, Arctic most probably becomes practically sea ice free, which means less sea ice than 1 million square kilometers before 2050. There may left some of the oldest ice, but yeah, it's a totally different story. And what it says actually that there is no dependence of what we do in the mean of the emissions, what will be the emission scenarios. That warming is already locked into the Arctic system. It will be ice-free somewhere before 2050. Only the question is, which depends from our behavior, how much, which emissions scenario we follow, that how often it happens, how many years it will be ice-free. That is something we still can probably change. So this is one of the most iconic images taken on Earth from the crew of Apollo 17, when the whole Earth was visible in 1972, this so-called blue marble. There have been 1,000 photographs taken of the Earth afterwards by satellites, and many of them, these polar regions as white patches, are clearly distinctively visible. But now we know that one of them, the northern region called Arctic, is turning into blue more and more, and white color is disappearing. And as one of the distinguished Arctic researcher, Mark Sirisa, puts in his book, that as Arctic loses its cryosphere, it also loses its soul. And I think it's very much right that these change is so remarkable that we will gonna see its consequences in the following years. That this what we see now is most probably only the visible part of this ice tip of the iceberg, the visible part. But what is submerged down there, this is something we need to be discover yet in the future. Thank you.
I guess we shall have the questions later. At first, I forget to introduce myself. I only forward the greetings of our president, but I forget to tell you who I am. So my name is Katrin Savomägi, and I'm the executive leader of Estonian Polar Club. But okay, now I want to introduce you our next man from Estonian Polar Club, Dr. Martin Liira. He is a lecturer of Tartu University and also the senior geologist of the Geological Survey of Estonia. Please.
Aitäh. Thank you very much, Katrin. Thank you very much for having me. It's a great pleasure to be again here in Polo Club and to have this international meeting with our fellows from France. So, Katrin already introduced me, so I will skip that part, since that's not so interesting. But I would like to say a couple of words about what me and my colleagues and my students are doing here in Estonia. Before going into the Arctic, which Timo gave us a very nice overview, I would like to say a couple of words about Baltic Sea, because that's what we currently are studying here, and I know that all the Dara fellows here are also currently studying, especially the Baltic Sea, which is very good, because I love Baltic Sea. It's good that you are studying that. But as a geologist, of course, I can't say anything about the geology, of course. So, for geologists, Estonia has been and is actually still a part of the Arctic. 20,000 years ago, in the last glacial maximum, Estonian area was covered with a thick land-based glacier. After it retreated, it gave us our landscape, Estonian landscape, which is dominated by the glacier retreat processes. And some of the processes are very exactly the same as we can see now happening in the Arctic, when the glaciers are retreating in the Arctic region. For example, the iceberg blow marks in the Barents Sea, glacier is breaking up and we have icebergs scratching the seabed surfaces. These kind of blow marks we can see in the Baltic Sea also. And they are exactly the same. Studying those blow marks, we can go back in time and we can study how the glacier was retreating, how much the icebergs were produced, and etc., etc., etc. So, for the geologist, Estonia is still a part of Arctic. And to understand what is happening here in our region, we can better understand what is happening in Arctic, in Barents Sea region, for example. And if we know what is happening in Arctic, we can also have maybe a better understanding what this future in Antarctic will look like. But to come as a geologist into the sea, of course, we like to study the seabed sediments. And this is fascinating thing to study, because the seabed sediments, they represent globally the ultimate sink for what is happening on land. So they are preserved here in the sediments layer by layer. And when you sample the sediments, you can go actually back in time. So here is one sample of seabed sediments produced with the seismoacoustic profilers. But sampling different depths here, we can study the sediment chemistry, for example. And here is some samples from the Baltic Sea in the mouth of Finland, where we've studied different compounds like heavy metal pollution in the Baltic Sea sediments. And we can see some really good trends the majority of the heavy metals like lead or zinc or cadmium, they all tend to have maximum peaks something around 60s and 70s. And this well correlates that during the 60s and 70s, everybody were crazy and just putting harmful stuff into the sea. But after that, local communities, all the countries around the Baltic Sea, put the packs together and decided that no, we have to do something. We can't go on with this trend here. We have to do something. And the HELPCOM commission was started, and some regulation was applied. And actually, we can see nowadays that for example, for the heavy metal pollution, the levels have been dropped. But for me, as a marine geologist, these graphs, it also gives some additional information. If you go back in time quite a lot before the Industrial Revolution, we can see actually the natural pollution level in our regions. That all lead is not something humans have put into the sea, but some of that is natural, and we can, if we go back in time sufficiently, we can detect the natural level of lead concentration. And in some cases, there are indications that this is even better now. Of course, back there is a nickel profile, for example. Not everything is so beautiful as these first graphs here. Some of the pollution levels are still increasing in Baltic Sea sediments. And although we know about a lot about heavy metals and we can study them, and we have some very good regulations regarding the heavy metal pollutions, for example, persistent organic pollution is still a big problem, an emerging problem. But let's leave heavy metals. One of the big problems in the Baltic Sea is, of course, as you all may know, eutrophication. The excess of nutrients in our waters, which creates a huge algal blooms, and in the end, it decreases the water quality and the oxygen level in our home sea. These nutrients, mainly the phosphorus, is also stored in our sediments. But to go and sample the seabed sediments and to measure how much phosphorus is in those seabed sediments, this is actually not enough. Although we can see that the phosphorus, total phosphorus in different basins can vary in a big, quite a big way, not all the phosphorus stored in the sediments is responsible for the eutrophication or can release back into the water column. Some of the phosphorus are in non-mobile form, like in bound to the calcium as apatite. This is absolutely non-mobile, or some long organic phosphorus form or aluminium forms, and so on and so on. There are different forms, and this is not affecting the eutrophication. But there are some forms, especially the phosphorus which is bound with the iron in our sediments, can, in in special conditions, can be released back from sediments into the water column, and this can still fuel the eutrophication problem in the Baltic Sea. So even if we stop all the phosphorus coming from on land into the Baltic Sea, there is still a lot of nutrients, a lot of phosphorus stored in our sediments, and we have to know better in order to better understand what is the Baltic Sea future gonna be in 20 or more years. So that's a very big issue we are doing here in Estonia. Of course, going back in time with the sediment cores, we can detect the natural levels of, for example, the mobile phosphorus forms. But these are the sample, some graphs from Riga Bay region, where we can see that the mobile phosphorus is well correlated with manganese concentration in our sediments. This actually indicates that some of the mobile form of the phosphorus actually is related to iron manganese nodules. This is a very unique thing we have in Baltic Sea, but all other seas also have those. Which is completely different theme that we can have a next polar forum talking about only about iron and manganese nodules. But it seems that these nodules are affecting our phosphorus balance in our accumulation basins very, very, very much. So while you go deep into issues, you often find new problems to be solved. But this was just a couple of things I would like to stress out about our studies in the Baltic Sea. Of course, there are other things also we are doing here, but probably the pollution and the eutrophication problems are one of the biggest ones. But of course, as a member of a Polar Forum, Arctic has been also my big love, and it still is. And today I would like to talk about more about Svalbard and about Svalbard's biggest fjord system, Isfjorden. I was lucky enough to live there for 2.5 years to study the seabed sediments around Svalbard. The main fjord system in Svalbard, the Isfjord, is when the scientists came and started to map the seabed, they discovered there are a lot of those small pits or craters in the seabed. These small pits or craters, they are called pockmarks, and those marks in the seabed are often related to the different hydrocarbon fluid explosions. But the theory is that wherever in a otherwise flat seabed you can see those small pits or craters, it indicates that either there has been or there is actually going on some hydrocarbons emissions from the seabed. And of course, like Timo already told us, the Arctic warming is a global issue and we need to better understand what's happening there. So when I arrived to the Svalbard, these pockmarks were already mapped, but the question was, are those pockmarks active or are they not? So we made several expeditions and field works. We collected a lot of seabed samples and we collected gases from there. And what we discovered is that the gas level in the seabed sediments is actually quite low, but there is no difference between those pockmarks or undisturbed seafloor. But the small amount of gas was coming all on different places and not only from the pockmarks. The unique thing about Svalbard is that the geology there is just perfect. It has almost all the rocks in the world, so it's a perfect place for geologists to be. And there are also some rocks containing oil and gas. So there is also always a chance that some of these natural gases or oils are seeping out from the seabed and causing additional global warming. Our study indicated that most of the gas coming out was thermogenic, meaning that it's coming from a deep source, so it's local, although some bacterial oxidation was also happening there. Most of the gas in the greenhouse gas, mainly the methane, in the seabed sediments are usually oxidized already in sediments. But if the emission is large enough, some of the gases are going out from sediments into a water column. And in a water column, you can actually detect those seeps. Here is some acoustic picture of a seabed where you can see some pockmarks, but also these funny things we call flares. Studying those these flares, we don't know exactly what is the composition of these flares, but this is gas coming out from a seabed. So, and here's an example that some of those flares in places where you have big emissions, a lot of methane gas is coming out from a seabed, can be very, very high and very intense. So after sampling those pockmarks in Isfjorden and discovering that the no pockmarks are not active, our research goal was then to study is the gas coming to a water column and can this gas pass to the atmosphere. So our research group, our recent paper, mapped the Isfjorden area and we collected flare data, measured the flares and the spatial and temporal variations in those flares, and what we discovered was that that most of the flares were related to the geological formations, which are known to contain a lot of gas and oil. So there is a natural thermogenic methane emissions coming out from the from a seabed into a water column. Although in water column most of the gas usually is oxidized into the less climatically more neutral CO2, but nevertheless in shallow fjord systems some of the gas can still seep out into the atmosphere and produce additional global warming. So that was a couple of glimpses of the works we have done in Arctic and also in Estonia. I just want to remind you that its seabed sediments are also one of the end members of the Arctic climate system or any natural systems. And in order to properly understand what is happening, we need to go also into the sediments to know the past changes. And this is unique also in Arctic, but also in Baltic Sea and so on. Yeah, thank you. That was my little introduction.
thank you, Martin. I just want to add that just now, when to compare how many Estonian researchers are working in Arctic or Antarctic, so just Arctic is the main subject, and more precisely Svalbard. And that's why we wanted to introduce just what we are doing there. But now I'm very happy to announce that Romain Troublé, Director General of Tara Ocean Foundation, will join with us via Zoom.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear us?
Me?
Yes. Can you hear us?
I need to pass to share my screen, and I cannot allow the right to do it. If you can just modify the Zoom. So thank you for having this forum. It's fantastic to be able to exchange. I'm sorry not to be here, and so that as Marcel as well. But we are very happy to be with you, and I'm always very happy to see Timo and to listen to Timo. It's always a great moment, to have to say. So I think you see my screen now soon. Yeah, okay. And I will try to share this, not sure it works. Yes. So, this is Tara. This is when we've been at, you saw the boat in Tallinn recently. That was a year ago, more or less a year ago in Antarctica, when Tara was working around the, specifically around the biology, around an iceberg, the big one, that was coming out of the Weddell Sea in Antarctica, in the Antarctic Peninsula. I like to use this picture of Apollo, and I think Timo, you will use it as well. I think it's very important that all of us are people, and people who are not very well into all this curiosity of science, is understanding that we really are living on a magical place in the universe. And it's very small, and it's like a jewel. And I like when to start to teach people what we talk about when we talk about the ocean. And I like this picture that shows the relative size of things. And I think it's a very important picture to explain our compatriots, our people, how small is the ocean, how small is the water on the planet compared to the size of the planet, how small is the salt water that you see here. And, Even though how small is the freshwater in glaciers, which is the small dots in the middle of this water bowl. So all the ocean water fits into this sphere, and I think it's always striking me how small it is, and where life is coming from there, and life is sustained in a way by the ocean. And it's always a crazy thinking. And When we are on the beach, when we are on the coast of Tallinn, looking at the ocean, you really feel that it's endless and very deep, and we can put everything we want, we can take everything we want from the ocean without having an impact. And we see more and more every day now that we do have a huge collective impact on this planet and on this ocean particularly. So, you know that the ocean is a life support system, captures a lot of carbon dioxide every day. it produces a lot of oxygen every day. Part of the oxygen produced on Earth every day is produced by the petrochemical ecosystems. These are consensus numbers. Of course, it's hard to measure really precisely, but these are common consensus. And the ocean is also regulated a lot about the temperature. And you recall from Timo's presentation that the warmth is having an impact on glaciers and also on the Arctic, as Timo explained to you. And yet, this ocean is big, but it's, we don't barely know nothing. Just the last 5 years, we surveyed 10% of the ocean ground. We were 15% 10 years ago. Now we are 25%, has been mapped. So we are progressing, which is good. But yet, when we talk about the life and how life is behaving and how life is producing oxygen so much and storing carbon dioxide and how we do it in the future, we have still a lot of work to do with the scientific community. And we are all connected to the ocean, and many, many places where we do conferences, people say, well, I don't care about the ocean, I live very far from it, so. But we are all connected to it. And the heat we exhaust is warming the ocean. The acidity level of the ocean has increased by 20% since the Industrial Revolution, so it came a lot, and it's completely continuing, and this acidity is a very, very, very long-term, has a very long-term inertia. And plastic waste is very popular. We see that many places plastic is everywhere. It's like a marker of our impact on this planet globally. So the foundation has grown up since we've been working in the Arctic with Timo and during the Damocles program. We have grown up. We are now a full foundation, which is a complete non-profit entity, which is the Goat Tower, belongs to the public domain, in fact, now. It doesn't belong anymore to the owners, original owners, ISB and her son, who launched this program 20 years ago. And the foundation has two missions. One is to explore the ocean, really understand it, to bring scientists on board, public scientists like Timo, like many others, like Marcel, of course, and CNRS, and a lot of laboratories around the world. But also share that nature, because science is not enough. We see that IPCC models, IPCC numbers, they're coming out in 30 years, but it's hard to convince people that there is something happening. And I think that telling stories and human stories is the way to engage people more and more and to a collective awareness. And that's what we try to do with the Tara calling in the harbors, but also with the Tara that will be in the ice in the future. And ultimately, our goal is to really advocate for the protection of the ocean. That's really our goal. And since this drift that we did together with Timo and with Damocles, many other teams of the foundation, we have done a lot. We have crisscrossed the planet since then. The drift is the red one on the top here. But we have crisscrossed the planet during the looking at the plankton ecosystem, looking at the reefs, coral reef ecosystems, looking at the microbiomes, looking at the plastic in the ocean, looking now, as we speak, in Tallinn about the chemical inputs and its impact on the biodiversity of the coastlines of Europe. So we've been working at sea, and we've been sailing 500,000 kilometers since then, so it's kind of a lot of distance. And always with this approach that's from genes to ecosystem. How can we use the technology of genes to better understand the diversity of life and to better understand what life is doing in the ocean, who is there, what are they doing, and what would be the fate of these ecosystems in the future. And the Arctic is one of the key parts where we have a very, very few knowledge. And this work that we have done on life, you recall from Timo that we really focused on the physics of the Arctic. The climate and the physics of the ocean, only the physics parameters were the core of the study of Damocles programs back 15 years ago on Tara in the Arctic. And since then, we really worked a huge and a lot on the life of marine life, microscopic marine life, planktonic life, more or less. And this work has been done by all the consortium, and it's been published in very in amazing journals. You can see during the covers of them in many times. And also, the data has been used by 900 by in 900 other papers since then. And so it's a huge, I mean, huge impact, you know, of the work that has been done on this. On this biology and marine life, and it's a great achievement and a great endeavor for the foundation to attract private funding to try to co-finance and to launch such expeditions that are very sometimes very hard to fund and very hard to share with the people. And sharing is the key. And this is taken two pictures taken in Japan, it was 6 years ago. And it's really important to share the science, to share also the adventure, to share also the curriculums of scientists who are dedicating their life to this knowledge, to this science, why they do it, what did they do to come here, how was it to join in and to try to inspire other kids. And rapidly speaking, we over 20 years, we have worked with 1 million kids in the French schools in France with their teachers. Not only for one time or one day, but for weeks and months at times, every time. And we had the chance to welcome 100,000 kids all over the place since 20 years. We visited 60 countries, and we did 250 postcards like the one in Tallinn today, to attract and to exchange and to show what and what mostly science at sea is about and why it's important. So, very different in place to places, of course, because it's a very cultural approach as well to the planet, but it's very interesting to share that. So I mentioned the plankton, this is really beautiful organisms, it's very aesthetic, we could make fantastic jewels out of them, but they are amazingly, discovering the plankton when we were beginning Tara was a crazy moment. I'm a molecular biologist by training myself, and a sailor. I did the America's Cup twice, with very high level sailing competitions. But this discovery was really a story of life, I would say. And we did study the ecosystems also in the reef. We spent 3 years in the Pacific. Yeah. This was 7 years ago, 5 years ago. We did a lot of dive and a lot of samples have been collected to understand better why this is changing so fast. So, since the Arctic Tara have been crisscrossing a lot the planet for many other topics like plastic pollution, and as I speak now, with around the Tara Europa track programs with the EMBL involved, and this was a new way. For the first time ever, we are close to land, and for the first time ever, we are close to Europe coast. Trying to focus on its diversity of life and the watershed pollution that we can see, chemical pollution that we can measure and see and objectivize. That is not to talk about clean areas or disgusting areas, but really better to understand better what is the fate and what is the role of chemical pollution on biodiversity and ecosystems. And we do it from land to the shore, Tara is at sea, and EMBL is having team in trucks that are doing the sampling on the land and the coastlines, and we are also trying to do the same sampling, the same protocols along the coast of Europe, as we are now in Argentina. Back to the core of our work, and Marcel will talk more about what are our intentions scientifically in the Arctic Ocean with the next problem. And, we did the drift, as you can see here. We did also sail around the Arctic Ocean in 2013, 10 years ago already, my goodness. And we did a lot of survey, we did a lot of impact, kind of sea trials to monitor the life, microscopic life, planktonic life in the Arctic Ocean, around the Arctic Ocean, during this trip, this back trip here. It was an amazing survey, and a very nice paper came out of this program. But now we are preparing the next one within the French Polar Strategy and within the French State Investment Programme called the France 2030 and many other private partners you can see here, including the Fondation France-Albert de Monaco, we're trying to also come back to the Arctic because it's melting fast, and you heard about that from Timo. And also it's very hard to predict the future. If you could try to predict the life response to climate transition that we see in the Arctic, the models that we can use are very, very well different. I mean, it's very hard to predict what's going to happen in the long term. In the short term, it's pretty, and you can see pretty accurate, but once we pass by 2050, we start to change the way we understand what's going on. So that's a question. And that's why we decided to reinvest into the Arctic, and not with TAR, because doing biology sampling with the TAR schooner in the very cold harsh weather in the Arctic is very impossible to do it from the deck. And so we need to have a new vessel that will be drifting in the Arctic Ocean, like an international North Pole station, in fact. It's pretty small. It's the same size, more or less, size range of the TAR schooner. 27 meters long, 40 meters wide, 300 tons, which is twice the weight of TAR. It's also three times the volume of TAR, so it's much more spacious for the people on board. And the idea is to again drift 400 to 500 days in autonomy with 12 winter crew and 18 summer crew on board. And so it's a aluminium vessel, same technology, same architect as the TAR schooner. We took the same guy, the same know-how. And our attention is to deploy on this vessel what the knowledge we have of drifting a vessel in the Arctic, which is not very common, and you have from Timo, but also to deploy on this station the know-how we have developed with the biology, with ocean biology on TAR since 15 years now. So it's really a joint effort, to really try to make the most of our know-how that's been developed by the teams of the foundation and the laboratories involved in there since a long time now. And you can see more details, you see the four floor ship. You can see here. You have atmosphere and I also the sensors on the roof. You get sensors, ocean sensors in the keel, looking at the currents, looking at the marine life as well. You have a moon pool in the middle to be able to send and do sample of sea ice from below by divers, or with these devices and gliders. We can use drones that we may use from the inside of the vessel, to be able to work in a manageable temperature. And then on the second floor, you see that there's a huge handling area, wet lab, as we call it. And if you look at this level, at the back of the boat on the left, you see all the wet lab, the dry labs. There's two dry labs, and there is scientific microscopic lab, -20 microscopic lab, there is a HEPA lab, there is electronic labs. So this is half of the boat is dedicated to the science with the moon pool in the middle. And the front of the boat will be the cabins, 12 cabins for 12 people in the winter. I think it's important to be able to be quiet and alone being alone in the Arctic. Being alone is very in your cabin sometimes. It's very bizarre, but I think it's very useful. And then it's a vessel that is dedicated. I mean, we try to work a lot on its footprint. The exhaust of the energy generators. We try to work a lot on the water exhaust. I mean, for the gray waters of this compound, of this station, to try to minimize as much as possible the impact. And the plan is to, we think we're going to burn something like 150-200 liters of oil every day for the energy, to try to minimize as much as possible the impact we could have on the environment. We're going to study on board. There will be six crew members, and there will be six scientists engineers that will be on board in the winter. and then more people in the summer for shorter periods. In the winter, as you know, in the Arctic, it's a 7 month commitment. But in the summer, we have a lot of ships coming by and passing by, and we also can do airplanes rotations, so it's more like a month and a half, 2 months in the summer. It's a bit of a fancy design. It will not be like Star Trek, it will not be like that, but this is the idea of the volume that we talk about in this lesson. And of course, there will be a doctor on board to manage each one. We also have to do the ice safety as well, but it will be a long, as it will be a very long journey in the week sometimes. And rapidly, I would like to emphasize that the people who are working with us, the science, since the beginning of the inception of this program, and CNRS, and Marcel is from CNRS, I'm from TACUVIC, from the University of Laval, thank you Marcel for being here, and many other laboratories that we see here who are with us since now 2 or 3 years to think about what we should do as a person, and what we should plan for the science. And I would like to Marcel to continue on that. Thank you.
Should I start?
Thank you.
We can take questions at the end.
Yeah, welcome, Marcel, from far away from Canada, I guess.
Yes, I'm located in Quebec City at Laval University, where I lead a laboratory which focuses all its activity on Arctic science, both ocean and terrestrial systems. And this laboratory is a partnership between CNRS in France and Laval University, which is a very active university in Canada, working on polar ice system. So I am myself an oceanographer, dealing with light in the ocean and microalgae and photosynthesis. And I've been leading a number of large projects in the past over the past decade and a half, looking at the response of marine ecosystems to climate change in polar systems. But I've been involved for a number of years now in contributing to the designing a research plan for the Tara Polar Station. We are three scientific coordinators, Chris Baller, Lee Carbus from the University of Maine, and myself. And we work with a large group of Arctic experts and also members of the Tara Consortium, who are mostly biologists, to get ready for the first expedition by the Tara Polar Station. So I will tell you in this short presentation what our priorities will be with that facility. Let me share with you my presentation. Okay. So let me start with few facts about the Arctic Ocean, which are relevant to our scientific program with the Tara Polar Station. So you may not have realized that the Arctic Ocean is the most polar ocean. It's the most polar ocean because it does occupy the North Pole, while on the southern side of our planet, I mean, the South Pole is occupied by land. About everything about 80 degrees of latitude in the north is covered by the ocean, while it's covered by land in the Antarctica. And it makes a big difference in terms of how polar this ocean is compared with the south. For instance, in terms of temperature, the Arctic Ocean is really the coldest ocean system, because compared with Antarctica, where much lower temperature can be found above land, above the ocean, I would say it's relatively warmer. Sea ice is thinner. during summer, there's really no more sea ice during any summers in the South Pole. But really, the Arctic Ocean is very special in that sense. As you know, the Arctic Ocean is covered by sea ice. What you see here is an example of the sea ice extent during March of this year. This is the time of the year in March when the ice pack in the Arctic is the largest every year. In fact, it covers about 14 million square kilometers. And this is the extent of sea ice during September of last year. This is a typical extent, every that is a minimum extent that is reached during each September. The yellow line is an average extent from 1981 to 2010, and the white surface is just the extent recorded during September 2022. So what you see on the right is the sea ice that survives to summers, and so it's older sea ice. And really the oldest sea ice is found close here to, well, in the central Arctic, but also north from Greenland and the Canadian archipelago. So sea ice is very present in this marine systems, which makes it very special. Another peculiarity of the Arctic Ocean is that it can be also the darkest and the brightest. It's the only, in a sense, it's mostly the only ocean where one can experience a polar night above the ocean, because in the Antarctica, there's very few ocean areas where a polar night can be experienced. While in Arctic, it is experienced at many different latitudes. It can be short and rather not so dark, beyond the polar circle. And it can be at North Pole, the polar night can be really dark, and for many days here it can last more than 150 days, for instance, around the North Pole. And it's the same for the midnight sun. One can experience also endless days around the summer solstice, over periods that can be short, close to the polar circle, and long around the North Pole. So that creates a very special light regime, and we will see that that significantly impacts living organisms that thrive in this system. What about life in the Arctic? Well, first, when you go in high Arctic environments, this is what it looks like on land. In general, it's a lot of rock, a lot of ice, not much vegetation. And in general, when there is vegetation, it's very small and not very productive. So the temperatures in many regions of the Arctic are so low that they prevent life to develop massively on land. But life, in fact, in the Arctic is in the ocean. The ocean is an oasis in the Arctic because the ocean is rather warm. You know, while one can record temperatures lower than minus 40 degrees during winter around the North Pole, in the ocean, it's never colder than minus 2, minus 1.8. So it's relatively warm compared with the with air temperature. And in fact, this is where life is present, is mostly present in Arctic. And therefore, it's not surprising that most human communities are located in the shores, close to the ocean, and depend to a large extent on the ocean to survive, because this is where they find food. So these ecosystems are quite specialized. They include, marine systems, they include microbes, viruses, bacteria, microalgae, other protists. They include zooplankton, fish, and marine mammals. Seabirds are included. And in Arctic, there's a number of emblematic species, like or groups of species like seals and polar bear. One special aspect also in this system is the richness of life on the ocean bottom, which is quite peculiar to the Arctic Ocean. One other peculiarity with regard to life in the Arctic is the presence, its presence within sea ice. Sea ice is a very important biome in the Arctic and polar systems, in fact, in the ocean in general. We've known for decades now that many different types of organisms develop in sea ice, because sea ice is a porous, it's like a sponge, it's a porous medium that contains microspaces where the salinity of the liquid is so high that it never freezes, in fact, and allow life to develop. These living organisms are, to a large extent, small ones, microbes, but also small animals. And a number of larger animals depend on these smaller animals for their to live. For instance, polar cats feed on microorganisms and zooplankton that live in connection with sea ice. So this is a very important environment or ecosystem in the Arctic Ocean. So, as we heard before, the Arctic Ocean is experiencing many changes. For instance, an increasing temperature in air and in the ocean, decreasing sea ice extent, thickness, and age. For instance, let's look at age on these different plots. What you see here at the top here, the areas in white indicate sea ice that is older than 4 years, that has survived more than four summers in 1995. And this is here on the right, you can see the extent of this old sea ice that is much smaller now. So old sea ice is kind of disappearing. So that's a major change in these ecosystems. The Arctic Ocean is freshening because of increased inputs from surrounding rivers, from melting glaciers as well, and ice sheet. New species are migrating from the south. New species of microbes or microalgae or even fishes. New species have been observed already. There are major changes in ocean and atmospheric circulations with impact on sea ice, impact on lower latitude, on weather at lower latitude. More pollutants are coming with the atmosphere and the ocean currents from the south, including different things, mercury, persistent organic pollutants, or micro and nanoplastics. And marine transport, shipping, increases also significantly. In general, the presence of human increases significantly in the Arctic with either shipping or tourists. So what do we plan to do with the parapolar station to address some of these major changes that call for more action, more time to understand what's going on in the system and how this system could be affected, to what extent it could be resilient to all these different changes. And our focus is really on the biology in the Arctic Ocean and anything that relates to biology. So the approach that we will follow with the parapolar station is the one that was used for the first trip experiment achieved with the Tara schooner in 2006 and 2007. You see here the trajectory from the deployment here in the Baltic Sea to the Fram Strait in 2006-2007. And this map, what you see is the drift that was accomplished with the German icebreaker Polaarfoorum in 2019 and 20. So they followed the same approach as with the parachuter, but with a much, much, much bigger team. And this was a very, very ambitious program, which mostly focused on atmospheric processes, the interaction between atmosphere and sea ice in the ocean. It was to a large extent driven by physicists of the atmosphere and the ocean. And on top of that, some studies of biogeochemistry and of ecology were conducted. And they had all these things had to share with a large platform during the experiment, and they had to deal also to the huge footprint of such a platform on the environment surrounding the ship. One has to consider that when you deploy such a platform at the beginning of the drift, I mean, at some point you get into an ice floe, and then this will be your surrounding for the rest of the expedition. So anything that pollutants or black carbon that come out from the ship will deposit around the platform, and that may have an impact on your on your work, especially for those working on snow, for instance, or sea ice. But the idea with the parapolarization is to, again, to explore the central Arctic, which is the most remote place in the northern hemisphere. We consider it still as a place where we need to accumulate data on the different problems I mentioned. And let's see what we will focus based on the strengths of this platform, which is a small one compared, for instance, with the Polaarfoorum. So first, we will address the Central Arctic again. We will look very much at sea ice, because this will be what we will have around us, and the upper ocean, because the deep ocean, you know, at several thousands of meters requires the kind of equipment we may not have to deploy, for instance, cores or large equipment with large winches. So we will really focus on sea ice, upper ocean, small scale, and look in the details at a number of processes and phenomena related to biology. So we will go through polar expeditions, and that's exactly as for Mosaic in the previous era drift experiments, but we will make sure that we cover very well all seasons from the freeze-up to the breakup, and maybe better than previous expeditions. Anyway, it will be repeated over 20 years. That's a major strength. Every second year, the platform will be redeployed in the Laptev Sea and will go through a new drift through the central Arctic, so that it will become possible to acquire a long time series and record trends and address year-to-year variations as well. The footprint will be small, much smaller, and as Romain mentioned, we will make sure that it is as small as possible. The platform will be optimized for observations and experiments related to biology, which means that we will have, for instance, sophisticated imaging systems, the type of systems that normally we don't bring on board ships. Because this platform will be stable, very stable, and it will be designed tri-purpose for such equipment, we will be able to deploy, for instance, high-resolution microscopes on this platform. It's also an ideal platform for atmospheric observation. We will install a number of equipments on top of the platform to conduct atmospheric observations in addition to observations on snow, sea ice, and in the ocean interior. The building blocks of our program are the following ones. So biology with omics, physiology, imaging, rig measurement, diversity, biogeochemistry, looking at solutes, gases, sea ice and snow physics will be a major focus, ocean physics will be a major focus, and atmosphere also atmosphere sciences would be another focus. But these will be the building blocks. What we are trying to do is really to design a science program that is optimal for this small platform, deployed for annual expedition over 20 years. So we have four priorities, scientific priorities. The first one is to use the Terra Polar Station as a long-term sentinel witnessing multi-year planetary changes. We want to record changes in the state of the atmosphere, state of sea ice, of the ice pack, and the state in the state of the ocean. We also want to record changes in biodiversity at all levels, microbes, fishes, birds, and so on. We want to look at changes in pollution in the Arctic, heavy metals like mercury, for instance, persistent organic pollutants, plastics, and nanoparticles. So in anything that we believe may change and may be used as sentinels of global changes. We'll look at black carbon also. Right. Our second priority will be to look at life in the frozen ocean. We want to better understand how life develops in sea ice and how this ecosystem functions. So we will use new methods to explore the micro niches at very small scale in sea ice and at the interface with seawater and the atmosphere. We will document diversity in sea ice, metabolic pathways. We believe that there are special metabolic pathways that exist in sea ice because of the extreme conditions that we find there in terms of salinity, of temperature, maybe of pH, and so on. We will address life history strategies, which refers to how life change over season, how some species adopt dormant stages or more resistant stages during, for instance, the coldest season or the darkest season. And this will allow us to better understand successions from one season to another and how this ecosystem exists from the freeze-up to the breakup. So we will document different features of sea ice at different scales. We will look at ridges, at leads, at microspaces using various methods, including endoscopes and RMI, for instance, systems to map the 3D structure of sea ice and the microspaces in which microorganisms develop. We will put some effort on the freeze-up period, because the freeze-up period is the period during which living organisms enter sea ice. This is when they colonize sea ice. And these colonization processes are not well understood at this time. We will also put some emphasis at the polar night. We now know that there's a lot of things going on during the polar night. The ecosystem is not sleeping during the polar night, and many important things happen during that time. So our third priority will be to determine how biology modulates climate through ocean, sea ice, snow, and atmosphere interactions. For instance, looking at production the impact of biology on greenhouse gases and on other climatically active gases like DMS that is produced by microalgae and has an impact on cloud formation, for instance. The production of water condensation and ice solidification nuclei of biological origin. We'll look at positive and negative feedback loops that are driven or involve biology. And we will also look at the impact of a changing ecosystem, because we know that, for instance, the changes recorded in fields will affect ecosystem, which in turn may affect the climate. But we want to look at that. And we will look at how the atmosphere impact at the atmosphere and the ocean impact the transport of microbes and the dissemination of biodiversity. Our last priority will address old sea ice, glaciation, evolution, and life in other ocean worlds. These aspects are kind of more curiosity-driven, fundamental. We think that these remain important topics that we can address in this kind of system where we find extreme conditions. So why glaciation and why evolution and life in other ocean worlds? Well, you probably know that our planet has experienced many snowball events. When sea ice was extended over a large fraction of the world ocean, you see these different snowball events here from the beginning of the history of our planet to today. Some of these events have lasted millions of years, but they have really been important on our planet. So sea ice, during some periods, has been a major ecosystem on Earth, because life was not yet existing on land. And sea ice maybe was the only place where white light was sufficient to support any life. Well, I'm excluding here the light that is supported by at the bottom of the ocean. Well, that's another thing. But anything that is related and supported by the energy of the sun could develop only at the surface. And if the ocean was totally covered by sea ice, I mean, this maybe much of the life could only happen in sea ice. Why not? So maybe during those periods, I mean, the sea ice extended merely to the equator, or at least to over a large fraction of the ocean. So sea ice is today an important ecosystem, and may have been an even more important ecosystem during periods when life did not exist on land and was evolving mostly in the ocean. So maybe some evolution of life on Earth has taken place in sea ice, and we don't know to what extent sea ice has played an important role in evolution of life on Earth. And why would sea ice be such an important ecosystem? Because sea ice has one peculiarity: it concentrates life. When you collect sea ice few days after it has formed, in general, the concentration of microorganisms is much larger than the seawater from which it has grown. And without any growth within sea ice, through some ways, microorganisms colonize sea ice and they concentrate there. Their concentration can be up to 20,000 times more than in the seawater from which it forms. And that makes the microorganisms very close to each other in microspaces. And this physical proximity among microorganisms favors the exchange of genes, what we call horizontal gene transfer, which is another way through which evolution takes place. And this phenomenon accelerates very significantly evolution adaptation in microorganisms. This is the process through which, for instance, microbes or bacteria can develop resistance to antibiotics very quickly. So one other reason why it is so important to look at this at life in sea ice is that sea ice exists on other planets and on a few moons, six moons of our solar system, including Tu and Celebes and Europa, which contains an ice pack on top of an ocean. And we wonder if there is life there, if there has been life, if life is possible. And to figure out if life is possible, I mean, the only thing we can do is to figure out whether life as we know it on Earth exists there. But and what I just said is life as we know it on Earth, which means we must know it very well. And we must know life also in extreme microenvironment. And sea ice is one of them. And sea ice exists on these planets. So we think that we can contribute to figure out better life on Earth, and especially in environments that may be to some extent similar to sea ice on these planets, even if the temperature are much lower and the sea ice is much thicker, as you can see on this this figure, which shows a model of what could be the ice pack on Enceladus and Europa with a 3 kilometer thickness on top of a 30,000 meter deep ocean. But it's a very different system, much, much, much colder. So, yeah. And these are, this is a list of metabolic pathways that some expert had identified, well, as happening on Earth and possibly happening on such planets. So we think we could contribute to make this list longer by looking at these different metabolic pathways using the different molecular biology tools that are mastered within the TARA consortium. So that's it for our plan. Hopefully you found it is exciting for us, for sure. It is exciting. We want to address really the impact of, the Arctic Ocean in the context of global change, but we want also to explore life in general in the Arctic Ocean and maybe learn something about the origins of life and maybe about the presence of life elsewhere. Thank you.
Thank you very much for such an interesting presentation. Ooh, it was. Now, please, we have time for questions. Who is first? Timo, please.
Yeah, hello, guys. Marcel, and hello, Romain, my dear friend. Now, I first want to say just a comment that this is very, very exciting. And I almost feel some chills. My question was, either of you can answer, how you plan to take this station to the spot where the drift should start? Is it steerable, or what platform are you going to use?
Yeah, I can respond to this one. This is a ship with an engine and a rudder that is steaming at 8 knots, like the kind of same speed as the schooner today. And so it's ice class vessel, not breaking ice class, but ice resistant class vessel. So the intention is to sail just the boat as we did with Tower, the same way, exactly the same way.
Oh.
Actually, I did not give you any agenda timing, but the boat is under building now, and we will start to weld the aluminium sheets in September. She will be splashed in the water in October, November 2024. So it's happening.
So it goes all the way by its own, just sailing there?
Yeah.
Okay, nice. So it's really steerable. But yeah, because I started to think that what I really mean, the strength of this program is this time scale, 20 years. Normally the drifts what have been studied Arctic are just one single season. So this is the really, really big strength. But I believe this is also the biggest challenge to keep it going 20 years. And I started already to think that, boy, how old we are, Roma, after 20 years.
20 years will be okay for me.
Yeah, have you been thinking of the someone who could replace you at some point?
Oh, yes, it's not written already, so there will be a journey.
Yeah, yeah. And then...
welcome young scientists in the field and to teach them and to transfer what we know to the next generation. So it's, that's why it's a long-term, it's a long-term journey that we have in mind.
Yeah, it's very exciting. Yeah, and then I can imagine that in 20 years we may have Arctic summer ice free. So it may just floating on the open ocean. And now it's very exciting. It really
can expect a shorter expedition by the time flows.
Yeah. It really, I feel it really connects the generations in the mean of scientists or researchers who might work on that platform during this 20 years. I can imagine this is a two generation project. Yeah, thanks guys.
Thank you for your
questions. Very honestly, when I read your email and the title, I thought it's a mistake. 20 years. 20 years for polar expedition, for drift. It must be a mistake. But now, it's interesting. What a possibilities. I just thought that here we have among Estonians young scientists whom will be very active after these 20 years. And I'm sure you have the questions. Oh, they are too shocked, it seems. But before, the director of the Maritime Museum, Urmo Stresen, he was very interested in the ship. It's not an ordinary sailing ship at all.
I confirm.
Tule räägi.
Easy ship to build.
I will give the microphone to the director of Maritime Museum. Maritime historian, specialist of the ships, and he doesn't believe that how this ship works.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. My name is Urmo Stresen, and I know that sometimes crazy ideas are quite good, and but the shape of the ship really it's unusual and. It's really unusual, and you are quite sure that it will work.
Yes, for sure. It's the same. Mm-hmm. It's the same hull as a tugboat. Mm-hmm. Like a tugboat, it's the same
behavior. And I just remember from the history, and it's from the naval history. It's a little bit far away from this field, but. There was once in a Russian Navy. It was a gunboat, just around like a circle. But I know that they are quite unstable for a sea, for a high seas, and they were also not so very accurate if it was necessary to use a cannon, but it was some kind of crazy ideas in those days, in the beginning of 20th century, that it might work. But I'm quite sure that you have planned it very carefully, and all your Tara has been proved many, many years ago how it's stable, and maybe not stable in the open sea. Yeah, okay. But
of course, it would be not a boat to sail across. At the beginning, it was a round boat, and then we did the calculations and we tried to model the behavior, and of course, it would not go anywhere, as you just said. So, so that's why it's a kind of an oval shape.
But anyways, it's very interesting, and I wish you good luck anyway.
Thank you. I tried to invite you on board to test it.
Hello, I have a question to Dr. Babin. I wanted to ask you if you could maybe explain in more detail how does this horizontal drift or the passing of the genes takes place between the microorganisms living in these microspaces in the ice. Thank you.
Well, I'm not an expert at that. First, let me start with that. And tell you, just explain that well. So the idea is that for these horizontal gene transfer to take place, first the microorganisms have to be close to each other to connect somehow through bridges or through different features. They have to connect to extremely small pieces of gene. That can happen differently in different ways. It can happen among bacteria. It can happen with a contribution from viruses. Well, viruses can be the vector to bring genes from one microorganism to another. So that's an important part. The viruses and bacteria can play a role in exchange of genes among protists. There can be exchange of genes among protists themselves. So all combinations seem to be pretty much possible. And these gene transfer, rather than the vertical gene transfer, you know, is gene transfer from one generation to another one of the same species. Horizontal gene transfer takes place within one given generation of microorganism, but from one species or one type of organism to another one. It takes place much more rapidly because there's no need for reproduction, asexual or sexual reproduction. Sexual reproduction. And so it has been in sea ice. Recently has been shown to take place, for instance, within microalgae. What has been found, the way they have identified that process is that one specific gene that codes for what we call ice-binding proteins, which are bright proteins that are produced to control the ice formation around the organism. It's like an antifreeze. You could consider it as an antifreeze. They found this same gene in species that were really far from each other in terms of phylogenetics. You know, for instance, the same gene was present, for instance, just an example. I'm not sure that this was the case in dinoflagellate and in diatoms and so on and so on. They share the same genes because they live in sea ice, and let's say one diatom that had this gene. If you take a species of diatom that is very close but live only in the seawater, it did not contain this gene. So this was one proof of horizontal gene transfer taking place within sea ice. And that contributed to adaptation of the microorganism. And we say adaptation because then this gene is transferred also to the next generation.
Thank you. There are more questions, please.
Thank you very much for the nice presentations. My name is Sirja, I'm from Tallinn University of Technology, and my question is about the labs that you're planning to have on board this polar station. So if you're staying there for quite some time in the sea ice, will you plan to do like some standard sample analysis already on board, or do you need to wait until you're back somewhere with more lab space and more equipment? Thank you.
Well, some analysis will be done on board. I mean, to the extent that it will be possible in terms of space, some analysis. I mean, well, some measurements are the just achieve live. For instance, if you send the temperature, salinity, sensor, and seawater, you get the data directly. For processing samples, some of them can be processed easily. For instance, if you want to measure chlorophyll concentration or some nutrients, and so on. We will do it on board, especially when it will guide our sampling. sometimes we need some data to plan the rest of the sampling, to figure out where to collect samples, for instance, in the water column. Or if we need to increase the volume of the samples because the amounts are too small, for instance, of the amount of microalgae, if you want to measure pigments, when there are very few in the water, you need to filter more water to collect a sufficient amount of microalgae. And to figure this out, you must do some pigment analysis on board. So in this specific case, we just measure chlorophyll A, not the other pigments. Just chlorophyll A is a very simple measurement. So we will do that for a number of variables. There's a number of analysis that must be achieved on fresh material that will have to be accomplished on board. For instance, if you want to look at microorganisms with some markers, some cellular markers, you know, you could use there's a number of cellular markers, fluorescent strobes that you can use to specifically look under the microscope at some parts of the cell, mitochondria or some membranes or whatever. Or lipids and so on. So this must be achieved on fresh samples, living cells that you put in contact with this fluorescent marker, and then you look at the cells under the microscope. So anything that must be achieved on board will be done on board. For instance, if we want to measure photosynthesis, of course we can do it only on living microalgae for these organisms. Yeah. But we are really trying to size the workload in the most realistic way. You know, we are calculating all the time. We need to do everything, all the sampling, the number of people we have on board, and given that they will spend long periods on board, I mean, we must not put a workload that is too heavy on their shoulders. And there's also, we are limited with the power, we'll be limited by the storage space, lab space. So, yeah, we are working very hard at the moment to list all the variables we want to measure, we believe that are essential, and we are considering everything that is related to the needs for space, power, and so on. And yeah, for conservation also, if you need to keep some samples at minus 80 or in liquid nitrogen, you have to account for that.
Thank you. Now I can say that people from Tara, actually you are also allowed to ask questions. But okay.
See, we built a boat to address these Arctic questions, biology more or less. Of course there will be physicians on board, atmosphere, climate. Of course, we need the context of all this biology. Of course, this is key, no? Don't misunderstand us. But we plan for the first drift, and then the next drift will be maybe different. I mean, question will arise, and we're going to change a bit the laboratories on board. We're going to change a bit the testing and the technique and strategy we use. So it will be a learn as we go, I think. Journey this project and time to time, expedition to expedition, new consortium will be built and new experts will come in from other countries. So it's really as Timo said, this is the Arctic Ocean we talk about, and we need to be very flexible and very agile in making this program over the next couple of years.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much. Do you have questions to our researchers? Or you know Timo so well, nothing to ask?
Timo very well. No, the other folks, I'm happy. Timo, if you want to.
Yeah, I have a question actually. To you, Romain.
No, because to be the engineer, one of the engineers on board for the next.
Oh, really?
Please go ahead. No?
Okay, I have a question. Just tell me when I have to buy a ticket of the flight to Paris.
Okay, I think we are going to start looking at people by mid-next year. So, yeah. In a year from now. I keep you posted.
Okay, it seems time to finish our joint Polaarfoorum.
Thank you very much to all and for your attention and for the time you gave us. Fantastic. Sorry to be with you.
Thank you very much. And if you need help, you know there are eager polar researchers in Estonia. Thank you and bye then.
Thank you. Bye bye.